your own personal life. So if we know that in Christ Jesus, we do pray that as we continue this worship experience, as we adopt our situations, circumstances, anything that will hinder our healing, that Christ will win. So if we know that in Christ Jesus, we do pray. Amen. We want to say good morning and welcome to the New Union Baptist Church. We thank God for you for sharing with us this morning. We praise God for how he continues to bless us in spite of ourselves. And as the song was ministering to us this morning, that's love, that's the love of God. God, he loved us so much that he sent his only begotten son that he might give his life a ransom for many. And all we have to do is believe on Jesus Christ. We thank God for his word this morning. And this is first Sunday we want to celebrate for those who might be celebrating birthdays. We pray that your wedding anniversaries, whatever's going on in the month of April, that God will continue to bless you. Amen. That's some highlights in my life as well as we came to the month of April. And I want to take this time as we look at 1 Peter. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 1 this morning. And by announcement, it might be posted on it. I'm not sure, but we were invited to do a sunrise service this morning. And that message would be posted as well. It came out of 1 Peter, different title, different points, but God is worthy to be praised. And so, as we're celebrating, I do want to pause as you're coming to 1 Peter. I want to thank the New Union Church. It was 7 years ago, April 1st, amen, that I was installed as pastor here at the New Union Church. I want to thank God for our missionaries, the class in which you have given. I thank God for the church for the beautiful cause that we're giving, and then by God's children and their parents. And they thought it not robbery to send me some Fannie Mae chocolate. And that is dangerous. That's dangerous because it's just like Oreo. You just can't eat one. Ladies and gentlemen, you just cannot eat just one. And so I got me a glass of milk. And then, of course, before I know it, you know, 4 or 5 pieces of candy is already gone. But we thank God for celebrating with us. We thank God for the 7 years that he has allowed us to fellowship here. At the New Union Church, we thank God for my wife, and we also bless her as well. We thank God how he continues to bless us in spite of ourselves. And so I just wanted to thank the church, to thank those who have sent cards, phone calls, and your lovely gifts. And it's not going unnoticed, amen. And I want those who might chime in to know that the love and gifts you have for us, amen. So we are going to go ahead and get started. I thank God for his giving, not only that he has given to us, but he has given to the church, the tithes and offerings. We pray that God will continue to bless you as he will continue to bless us. And so we just want to praise God on your behalf this morning, and as we continue to on this road called life, that we would continue to honor, serve, and glorify our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So this morning, 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 3, amen. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Just for a few moments this morning, we want to read for our subject his abundant mercy. Amen. This morning we with Peter, we talk about the glory that's to come. Amen. But as Peter's first letter was written, it is meant to encourage Christians to remain faithful in the midst of persecution. And what we have to understand is that if you are a born-again believer, you may have not recognized the trials and tribulations that were before you until you came to Christ. That was the kind of episode that was going on in the life of these Jewish Christians. But Peter, he's writing to remind them and us of our heavenly inheritance and drive home the point to live our lives in total submission to God's will, trust and obey. But like other books of the Bible, authorship is questioned. The eloquent literary style and impressive vocabulary made it hard for Bible scholars to believe that a fisherman from Galilee wrote it. In other words, when people look at you and I, we're ordinary people. But when we come to know Jesus Christ and the things that God is doing in our lives, sometimes it's hard for people to believe that you're a child of God. Yes, it is. The point I'm trying to make, but there are some things that people are doing that make you think that they're not Christians, But what I'm saying here is that the relationship that Peter had with Jesus Christ, the work in which he had done previously, you know, prior to becoming a disciple, they didn't believe that Peter had wrote it. But some scholars believe that the context of this letter is like Peter's speeches that we find in the book of Acts and also Mark's gospel. But others believe that Peter's co-labor, Sabanius, may have exercised his editorial skills to convey Peter's message, his personality, and his apostolic letter authority. Let me slow down. It is believed that Peter wrote from Rome during the time of Nero, when Christians were being tortured and killed for their faith in Jesus Christ. So I'm often reminded if someone came to you with a gun and said, if you confess Jesus Christ, I'm going to shoot you. I wonder what people would do. But the church at Jerusalem, they were being scattered throughout the Mediterranean world because of their relationship, their trust, their faith, and their hope in God. Now, Peter refers to his audience as pilgrims and strangers as a reminder that we are sojourners traveling through on our way to the promised land. But as the stone has been rolled away, Peter logically proceeds through this letter addressing the salvation of the believer, the submission of the believer, the suffering of the believer. But Peter presents Christ as belief, as the believer's example and hope during times of tribulation. He gives a divine perspective concerning these trials that we may endure without wavering in our faith. In other words, situations and circumstances, sometimes, you know, we are confronted with them. And what the Bible is teaching you and I, as believers of Jesus Christ, we're going to go through something, but Peter wants us not to give up. But look what he says here in verse 3 of him. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So begotten refers to producing something anew, being born again. The metaphor is to have one's mind changed so that he or she lives a new life conforming to the will of God. In other words, Peter is telling us the word on the street this morning is that keep hope alive. That's what Peter is saying. We must exercise our faith, believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and God raised him from the dead, that you and I might dwell with life. So suffering is a part of what we are to be about as we celebrate Jesus' resurrection. In our seven statements from the cross, we see that Jesus was suffering. Jesus was going through some things. People came up against Jesus throughout his ministry, and we're no different. People are going to come up against us. And Peter wants us to be encouraged that we might be going through something, but God, because of him being rich in mercy, his great love for us, he sent his Son that he might die for us, that we might have a right to the tree of life once again. The Easter in the life of a believer is every day. You know, every day is Christmas for you and I. Jesus Christ came that he might show himself to us, that the love in which God has for us, you know, through his Son, that he might give his life for us. And Peter is encouraging this church that Jesus Christ, he has been raised from the dead. That's what he says. But as I go to my seat this morning, abundance, it means to be thankful. You know, abundance, see, God is merciful. He is a merciful God. There are some things that God is, is holding back from us that we deserve, he's showing his mercy. You know, God is merciful. He understood. He knew that in order for us to be brought back in fellowship with him, he had to give us mercy. But it says his abundant mercy. Jesus is talking about, I love what the Bible says in Psalm 24, the essence of the Lord and the fullness thereof, the world that dwells therein. But my point is everything belongs to God. He owns it all. He knows it all. And he tells us today in our lesson that this abundant mercy is what God has given you and I, that we might have an understanding that God is indeed working in our life to will and to do all his good pleasure. But as I go and listen to a close this morning, his abundant mercy overshadows our suffering. So suffering refers to that which one suffers and has suffered pertaining to misfortune, calamity, suffering, even affliction. Peter wanted us to know that sometimes people are going to say some things. Sometimes people are going to do some things. They did it to Christ, and you're no different, but Christ suffered, and we as Christians must undergo the same type of hardship that Christ to do. So they want to go through some things, but you and I don't want to go through anything, but the Bible is teaching you and I, as long as you call on the name of Jesus Christ, people are going to say things, people are going to do things, and Peter is encouraging us that God's abundant mercy is overshadowing the stuff in which you and I were going through. Verse 11 says, "Certain of what manner of time the Spirit of Christ was in them did signify." And it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that to come. In other words, the reason why, his abundant mercy overshadows our suffering is because the glory in which God, the glory of God that resonates in the life of the believer, it overshadows the stuff in which you and I go through. You've heard that song, you don't look like what you've been through. It's because of God's abundant mercy. God is keeping you and I, and leading you and I, and has given us the understanding that we're going to go through, that because of his grace and his mercy, the things in which we go through, his mercy overshadows that. And what Peter is saying is that if we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died and God raised him from the dead, that we might have eternal life. And so if we have eternal life in the kingdom of God, it overshadows all the stuff that you and I will ever go through. So he's abundant mercy, not only overshadows our suffering, his abundant mercy opened the door to our salvation. Yes, it did. So salvation is the storm of benefits and blessings that his Christians are redeemed from all the ills of this world. Salvation means to be rescued. It means to be delivered, saved from sin's penalty, power, eventually from its very presence. Deliverance, preservation, safety. That's what salvation is. Jesus Christ, he is my Father. Yes, he is. He has kept me from a burning lake of fire. He's my lifeguard. He has saved me from drowning in the sea of sin. But the Bible is teaching you and I this morning as I listen to a close in verse 5. You are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter is encouraging us, and Peter is letting us know that his abundant mercy, it overshadows what we're going to go through, and then his abundant mercy is through that paved the way for you and I to be brought back into fellowship with the living God. He says in verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul. Peter understood he walked with God, and that might be another reason why they didn't believe that Peter wrote it, because he denied Jesus Christ. We all might deny him the way we live our lives, but the Bible is teaching you and I that he's a fucking mercy overshadowed one of the suffering that you and I have to go through, and not only that, he's a fucking mercy to pave the way that you and I may have salvation. Verse 10 says, as his salvation, the prophets have acquired, and they search diligently, he taught prophesy that the great things to come unto you. It's the voice of God that is helping you in our lives to will and to do as we see presences. And the Bible is written to you and I that Jesus Christ, who willfully gave his life, the suffering that he went through, the things that we're going to suffer, we're going to do certain things that he is writing that we might have hope with us, that this hope is that when Jesus Christ might not be the minister. And the Bible is written to you and I this morning, this abundant mercy, not only are the shadows of suffering, not only that we paved the way or opened the door to salvation, but his abundant mercy provides ongoing sanctification. So sanctification is God's through process of gravitating God that produces holiness in the life of the believer. Right here in this chapter, it tells them be no holier as God is holy. So sanctification, it means the purity, it's the cleansing power of God that is God cleansed and purified, has made pure the work in which he called you and I to do. But the bottom line is sanctification, it means to be set apart for God's use. So it's the cleansing of God that each and every day when we get up, his message on the media, they meet their first each and every morning, great ear, his faithfulness, the head of our building our faith this morning. So the sanctification is the Spirit of God who is continuing to work in our lives. You know, I thank God this morning to sanctification because, you know, I'm not where I ought to be. You know, I thank God I'm not where I used to be. But if you have to have the same testimony and you feel it's not, you're not being real with yourself. But let's look at this process of sanctification. Look what it says here in verse number 2. He says, according to the knowledge of God the Father, to the sanctification of the Spirit, and to the obedience and speaking of the blood of Jesus Christ. And the people of the Spirit, we will say that God will be the Spirit of God, in death of the truth, and that what Peter is saying to us, trying to say, we can just say before the foundations of the world, before the Father was said, and the Spirit, we were talking about coming down to the redeem us, and it says here that the full knowledge of the Father, to the cleansing and the power of the Spirit, and to the abundance and the spirit of the blood of Jesus, that has washed us, that has cleansed us from the sin that was in us. And so the Bible is speaking to you and I this morning. You can be found here in verse number 22. Because seeing you have been purified your faith, and you have gained the truth from the Spirit of unfailing love, you're the brethren, see that we love one another with a pure heart. In other words, God is still working on you. He's still working on me. The sanctification process is still at work in your life. The power to continue to sustain, to keep us, to hold down is the law of our lives. I love what the Hebrew writer says. He says in chapter 13, he says, wherefore, Jesus also, that he may sanctify the people with his own blood, has sanctified the law of the Lord. In other words, sanctifying is a part of the sanctification of experience that God has taught you and I to live, that his abundant mercy overshadows the suffering. Because his abundant mercy is the life of the Lord, that you and I might be saved. His abundant mercy is the ongoing sanctification process. He's telling us, 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 I'm not saying it's all, but don't go looking to things that Jesus will take it through. The Bible is telling you, you're in your life. He said, we're going to be a Christian. We're going to be a Christian. But you need to understand it. But Jesus has. Everything I'm trying to tell you, you're in your life. 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 You're in your life.
To Calvary, to save a wretch like you and